Hello everyone. So now we'll see what are the different applications of analytics and how to use them to perform this analytics. So in this session, you'll gain answers to the uses of analytics. Then we'll see what are the recommendations, this Google Suggest, this Amazon product recommendations, Facebook's news feed, video games, okay, FICO credit score, email spam filtering, USB's zip code recognition, behavioral advertising, and election campaign. So these are some use cases, practical business scenarios where you'll see how analytics was used and the role that was played by this analytics domain. Okay, so as you must be knowing, this particular website, this online retailer, Amazon, okay, uses analytics for recommendations and for various other reasons. So this is one of the most widely using, Amazon uses analytics, you know, as one of the most widely implementations across their domain. And they use this for various reasons. So you must have seen when you purchase some item on this online store, based on the category of the item, based on the type of the item that you have selected, they come up with recommendations that the customers who purchased this particular item have also, you know, bought these items. So this is how they push, you know, customers for, for buying some new items, and they conclude that, you know, the customer may, you know, go for this particular item buying, and, you know, that way they can make profit out of it. There are various other applications that make use of analytics, like this taxi or movie apps, this food apps, this fitness apps. All these make use of analytics for, you know, some or the other reason. So several businesses have emerged that track customer data and solve various business problems. Like, for example, this taxi apps, you know, can easily locate your location. So the moment you start your journey, they can predict that, you know, approximately how much time it will take to reach your destination. Okay, and accordingly they charge the prices. And what is the peak hour demand, you know, when you are traveling by these, you know, this taxi services, and accordingly they can decide their fare, etc. We see this use of analytics nowadays in almost every domain, every arena of our life. So this analytics is used widely across, you know, sports also. So here you see the application of analytics in sports. So few of the key factors impacting success here is the opposition, the venue, the temperature, player performance, weather conditions, etc. So in sports, they can, based on the player's performance and based on the place where, you know, that player, you know, played, they can understand, you know, how this player is going to perform in future if he is given a chance again to play at the same venue, okay, under same conditions. So they do, I mean, lots of permutations and combinations there, and, you know, they come up with conclusion that, I mean, while selecting a particular, you know, player for a sport. So this is also used to predict, you know, the Oscar winners. So can we predict Oscar winners using data analytics alone? So it seems two technology firms, Cognizant and Clarabridge, claim they know which film will win the Best Picture Oscar this year. They have reached their conclusions not by watching the films and applying artistic criticism, but simply by crunching data, lots of data. They looked at 150 variables, from film genre to box office takings, from review ratings to the percentage of female viewers under 18, and they applied their algorithm to data going back 15 years to work out which of these variables were the most important. And then they come up with some conclusion that, you know, which movie is going to win the Oscar. Interestingly, they also measured sentiment, the emotional reactions each film elicited, on popular movie review sites such as IMDb and Rotten Tomatoes. Just to give some sense of the amount of data, the tech firms looked at 150,000 text reviews and more than 38 million star ratings from IMDb alone. The tech firms say they are 64% confident that the Revenant will win. So they came with this conclusion, you know, after doing a thorough analysis and conducting, you know, lots of analytics and applying lots of algorithm and model to the data that they gathered. This feature was the work of Kevin Gibbs in Google Suggest. Basically, they used, and this feature was the work of this Kevin Gibbs, who started out trying to build a URL predictor that auto-completes the URL as a user types it in. So you must have seen nowadays in Google, when you type something, before you complete typing your search word, you know, certain pop-up, you know, comes where your words, you know, mostly features. So based on previous searches which was done by the other people, I mean, they save all these frequently searched keywords in their repository, and when a new user types in, okay, they predict that the user might, you know, type this particular keyword, and they give all those in the suggestion box. So this idea was then ported over to Google search itself, driving a lot of adoption and saving users a lot of time while searching. So the moment you type some keyword, your keyword comes in a pop-up, and you can simply select that keyword and, you know, go ahead with the search operation. So Google Suggest leverages predictive analytics to give out real-time search query recommendations. As we discussed in our previous slide also, this online, one of the biggest online retailer, Amazon, use this analytics widely to push you for certain products that you haven't bought based on the patterns that they identified, you know, in your product, you know, based on your historical data. So we have all gotten lost in product research on Amazon.com, jumping from one product to another, comparing one list with another in a seemingly endless maze of products. This addictive shopping experience is due to the smart work of Amazon in the background, where they have perfected the art of cross-selling. Okay, so based on the items that you have purchased, they can push you for the other items which comes in the same category or you know, having the same behavior. So the context in which Amazon's recommendations are made include the item page that you have visited, the checkout page where you have finalized your items, the search result page where you searched for those items, the customized home page for a specific user, and the email promotions. These recommendations are based on aggregate data for tons of transactions and user behavior. Even this Facebook makes use of analytics a lot. So in recent times, have you noticed that Facebook increasingly prioritizes updates from your close friends and family more than others? In the early days of Facebook, the newsfeed used to have all updates from your friends in chronological order. The recent changes in prioritization is due to the predictive analytics algorithms at play, guessing which stories you had most interested in based on who you speak with most frequently and your profile information. So with this, they can gather you know, your information, and they can filter out, they can search people having the same pattern or having the same characteristics or features, and they can match or, you know, help you making friends on Facebook. Analytics is also widely used across gaming industry. So gaming companies like EA and Zynga generate a lot of structured and unstructured data from their games. So EA games generate a whooping 50 terabyte of data per day, according to a survey. So you can understand with this, I mean, the kind of storage environment and the kind of analytical tool that you need to analyze such voluminous data. This data is in the form of gameplay data, microtransactions, and timestamps, in-game advertising, multiplayer information, and much more. These companies see the huge opportunity to customize gameplay, find new ways of monetizing games, and even enriching the gaming experience by making it social. This organization FICO also uses analytics in determining the credit score. It uses factors such as on-time payments, credit capacity used, and duration of credit history to assign each person a score. This process of assessing risk when lending used to take banks weeks before, but now can be done in just few hours thanks to this, you know, business analytics. So they can easily determine who all are the eligible candidates whom they can allot the credit cards or the loans, you know. They need not go for any manual, you know, task for this, and they can simply do this, you know, quickly by using the analytical tool and the data repositories where the information of that particular customer has been stored. Unfortunately, as with all predictive models, accuracy is a concern, and even an established models like FICO score can go badly wrong, as in the subprime mortgage crisis of 2008. But most of the time, I mean, one can definitely rely on this, and before allotting anybody a credit card or loan, you know, when one can verify their details, their credit score worthiness, you know, with the help of this data that you have generated. So FICO score is used to assess the credit worthiness of a person and level of risk a finance company incurs when lending to that person. Analytics is also used to perform this spam filtering. So when Gmail launched back in 2004, it was lauded for its exceptionally better spam filtering than that time popular Yahoo Mail. Spam is a major concern for email users. When dealing with spam, email service providers need not only filter out spam email, but ensure the spam filters don't catch false positives. So it seems 86% of all emails sent are spam, according to this Bloomberg survey, which was conducted in 2016. So you definitely need, in case if you want to retain your users, the email users, you definitely need a strong and powerful system, you know, that can do the spam filtering for you. So spam filtering, as I said, you know, widely uses predictive analytics. Analytics is also used in some US states to identify the zip codes. This is used for zip code recognition. We don't often use snail mail these days, but the digit recognition system used by the US Post Office is an example of predictive analytics. The postal services needs to recognize the numbers in a zip code and sort it mail by zip code. It uses algorithms that have been trained to recognize handwritten digits. It has a large set of pictures that are labeled by hand as being in 0 to 9 and uses them to accurately identify zip code numbers on mail. So no matter how you have written those digits, what is the pattern of those digits, it can understand, you know, those with the help of the analytics models that you have implemented, and it can easily help you recognizing those digits. Analytics is also used for behavioral advertising. So advertising platforms are ever in the search of a better way to target ads to their user base, be it Google with AdWords or Facebook with their ads within the news feed, or advertising startups like, you know, Uber Ads, etc. All these companies and organizations make use of portals, make use of analytics widely. So they understand the pattern, the behavior of the users or the customers, and with that they come with some conclusion, and you know, they derive some meaningful insight that help them understanding the, you know, pattern of the data, and then, you know, I mean, doing their advertisement better. Analytics was also used during the US election campaigns. So predictive analytics used in an election campaign, you know, are complex. Predicting a single score or making an either or decision, okay, is not so easy task if you do it manually. So election campaign planners have long recognized the role of social media in deciding the outcome of an election. So what impact a particular messaging would have on a particular demographic group, you know, such questions can be answered easily by implementing analytics. So the next step is to leverage data in making more accurate predictions on the impact of their messaging. Thank you very much.